Good evening, everyone. Hello, how are you? Great. Welcome to our 2022 WETA lecture. I'm just here to get us started and give you the rundown on how things are going to go. So first, we're going to have Provost Hartley come and do the official welcome and pray with us. Then I will introduce Dr. Long. Then we'll have the speech. Then we'll have Q&A. And then refreshments. Okay? Good.
Well, good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to see a full room here, and greetings to those of you who are watching us online as well. It is wonderful to be here together to be celebrating our 2022 installment of the annual Winifred E. Weeder Faculty Award Lecture for Meritorious Scholarship. So as we begin, I would first like to acknowledge with gratitude that we are gathered tonight in a city that takes its name from Chief Seattle, chief of the Duwamish people, and that our campus is situated on lands both ceded and unceded of the Coast Salish peoples, the land which touches the waters of all the tribes and bands within the Suquamish, Tulalip, and Muckleshoot nations, people who are still here today. The annual Weeder Lecture was established in 1975, as you'll read in your program, to honor Dr. Winifred E. Weeder in the year of her retirement after she had served for 40 years as an SPU professor. The endowment itself to support the lecture was given by another SPU emeritus professor, Dr. Ross Shaw, who himself served SPU for 31 years. The Weeder Lecture provides a public platform from which the claims of the liberal arts are in the Christian University are espoused. Each year, a faculty member is chosen by his or her peers to receive this award and to present scholarship informed by a Christian worldview. Dr. Weeder earned her doctorate in 1933 from the University of Chicago, and when she joined the university, she was one of the few faculty members who had actually had an earned doctorate. She quickly set out to create first a course and then a whole department of classical languages. And over the course of those 40 years, her passion for languages and literatures inspired countless students. She was also interested in physical education, and she was SPU's first female coach, leading athletic programs for over a decade. This lecture is a wonderful tribute to the importance of scholarship in the vocation of the Christian University professor, and that legacy is something that is alive and well at SPU today. So I would invite you now to join me in prayer as we open this evening, and then, as Dr. Copeland said, she will be coming tonight to introduce our speaker. Please pray with me. Creator God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather tonight in your name and in this place to be reminded of your presence in our lives and in this world. We are grateful for the gift of human intellect that enables us to pursue truth, as well as for the gift of human community that allows us to do that work together. By the power of your Holy Spirit, open our minds and hearts this evening that we might hear and better understand the ways in which you love your creation and the ways in which we too can be inspired to loving care of that creation. We ask for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so I realize I did not introduce myself. So my name is Dr. Aiden Copeland, and I am the Assistant Provost of Inclusive Faculty Excellence, and I have the pleasure of leading these academic events and introducing my phenomenal peers. So without further ado, I just want to thank Provost Hartley and give everyone a warm welcome. I'd like to thank Lucy Israel, the office coordinator of my office, the Faculty Life office, and everyone who partnered with her to organize and support this event. Ultimate thanks goes to Jesus for allowing us to execute this event in person. Okay, without further ado, I'm honored to introduce our 2022 WETA honoree, Dr. Eric Long. Not only is he one of our distinguished faculty of the College Arts and Sciences, but a certified student favorite. More on that in a bit. At SBU, Dr. Long teaches upper division courses in ecology, conservation biology, forest ecology, tropical ecology, biostatistics, and vertebrate biology, as well as sections of the introductory biology sequence. His current research focuses on population ecology of black-tailed deer on Blakely Island, Washington, where SBU maintains a field station. He has recently published works titled Risky Movements: Natal Dispersal Does Not Decrease Survival of a Large Herbivore in the Ecology and Evolution Journal, and Effect of Male Age Structure on Reproduction in the White-Tailed Deer in the Journal of Wildlife Management. So those are his last two. Thus, it should be of no surprise to anyone if Dr. Long is not in the lecture hall. Chances are he is in his favorite classroom of all, the outdoors. Consequently, numerous courses of his are taught at SBU's field station or abroad, including winter break courses in Belize and Galapagos Islands. He was elected by the SBU student body as Professor of the Year in 2009. You see, as I shared, a certified student favorite. I am confident at this stage that you are brimming with curiosity about what our wildlife and outdoors loving professor plans to share with us tonight. Dr. Long's lecture is entitled Priests of a Fallen Creation, the Temple, Natural Theology, and Ecology in Dialogue. Dr. Long will endeavor to deconstruct both creation's goodness and decay by sharing his academic approach to addressing five roughly chronological questions ranging from creation to eschatology. Why does creation exist? How can we interpret the goodness of creation? What did and didn't happen to the creation of the fall? Why is the earth groaning? And where is the earth headed? And what is our role? So please join me in welcoming Dr. Long to the stage.
Thank you, Raydene. Oh, it's good to be here. It's good to be in person. It's good to be standing in front of you. It's good to see so many familiar faces, even with the masks. I'll just pretend you're smiling the whole time. All right. Before going any farther, I'd like to start with some thanks. Oh, we're going to have trouble with the slide advancer a little bit. We even practiced this. Do you have anybody at the... I even got two. And I'm double-fisting up here, and neither of them are working. I can check it. We might need to move the podium closer. We got it? It might have just locked up on the first slide. There we go. Let's try that. It sometimes takes a while to wake up. Let's try that again. All right, so some thanks before we get too far in this. First of all, the honoree, Dr. Weider. I never had the honor of meeting Dr. Weider. She retired when I was negative one, but I know that her legacy lives here. And then I also want to thank the benefactor of tonight's lecture, Dr. Ross Shaw, Professor Emeritus of Biology, who really is the patron saint of field biology at SBU. I did have the good fortune of meeting Dr. Shaw before he passed away a few years ago. And he's really the shoulders, the giant on whose shoulders we stand here. So thank you to Dr. Shaw. I'd also like to thank the organizers. A lot of folks went into tonight's lecture. Let's try it. There we go. Raydene and Lucy and the Faculty Life Office have put in a ton of effort to get this to go. 9 months late, but we'll take it, and I'm so glad we can be here. Thank you to the facilitators with ETM and facilities and CIS and University Communications and catering, and just it takes a village, right? I also want to thank my accompanist, Matea Kurtz-Shaw, who's going to be joining me here in a bit. More on that just in a moment. And my wonderful support crew, first and foremost, my wife, who has shown tireless patience and thoughtful insights as I've been chewing on these thoughts for a long time. My long-suffering students, who have heard more than one rant on this in the classroom. And I thank my colleagues, especially my colleagues in biology and in theology, for just a ton of encouragement that they've given me along the way. And a special shout out to Steve Parisho, the theology and philosophy librarian. Whenever I hit a dead end in the research, Steve was there to help open new paths for me, and I just couldn't thank him enough for that. And finally, Mike Langford in our School of Theology has let me bounce a lot of harebrained ideas off him over the years. And then if I ever started to wander a little too far, he gently pulled me back to center, reminding me of good things like God's omnipotence and God's omnipresence. So thank you, Mike, for that. It should go without saying, obviously, that any errors or heresies that remain in this talk are entirely Mike's. So now, I'm an ecologist, and maybe we should start out with what is ecology and what's an ecologist. Now, ecologists, we love field guides, so let me give you a few identifying features. Well, you know, if the Birkenstock fits. So while that may describe ecologists, it doesn't really tell us what is ecology. And as anybody who's taken my introductory biology class can tell you, ecology is the scientific study of interactions. The interactions that determine distribution and abundance of organisms. So we're all about studying interactions. As such, ecologists love arrows, lots of arrows, whether it's looking at how nitrogen might flow through a stream and into salmon and into bears and then into the trees, or whether how the trees might cycle carbon and pulling carbon out of the atmosphere and putting it down into the soil, or how energy might flow through a Pacific food chain. And this food chain here is drawn by my colleague, Dr. Ferrer, and as much as I love this one, there's one food chain that I like even better. This was a recent gift to me from my son. This is a Pacific Northwest food chain, and he's here in the audience. So I don't know if I like see that plankton in the lower left corner at the bottom of the food chain or the seal at the top of the food chain, but this is my favorite food chain. So congratulations, Torin, you're published, buddy. All right. So yes, we like our arrows. But in tonight's lecture, I'd like to examine some relationships, namely the relationship between humans and non-human creation. How were we originally called to relate with creation? What's gone wrong? What's the path forward? Many of us are familiar with the language of stewards of creation. Stewardship indicates we don't own the land. I like that. Stewardship emphasizes the need for wise management. I like that. However, the focus on management's been criticized for overemphasizing creation's production of resources. I hear that criticism and I take the point, but I think the model of stewardship still works, even if it's not perfect. What I'd like to do tonight then is offer a complementary, rather than strictly alternative, model of our relationship with creation. To do this, we need first and foremost good biblical theology. But additionally, I think we can also learn about the relationship between humans and the rest of creation by developing good natural theology as well. For those of you familiar with the debate, you'll know that not everyone is wild about the idea of natural theology. Chief among the critics is this guy, Karl Barth. Now, what Barth was criticizing with the idea of natural theology was that we could reason up to God through first principles of science. Barth's right. No natural theology can work up to God or work out a systematic theology of the Trinity. But this reasoning up from first principles is not necessarily what natural theology must be about. Alistair McGrath, a scientist and theologian, has written a lot about natural theology. And McGrath says, natural theology is not intended to prove the existence of God, but presupposes that existence. It then asks, what should we expect the natural world to be like if it has indeed been created by such a God? Rather than studying nature to prove the existence of God, we use what McGrath calls Christian natural theology, where we begin with biblical theology and then study nature as creation. McGrath calls this a theology of nature, or what we might call a theological ecology. And maybe, just maybe, we can get old Barth to buy into this type of natural theology. So I mentioned ecologists like arrows, right? And in this theological ecology, we can look at multiple relationships among God, humans, and non-human creation. Now, non-human creation, that's like a baggy term, right? It's a mouthful. And so for the rest of this talk, I'll often say creation, like to look at non-human creation. But don't get me wrong, humans are part of creation, all right? So that'll just be some shorthand. But tonight, I'm not going to try to unpack all of these relationships that I put up there. I really want to focus on three. First, what's the mission God has for humans, especially with regards to creation? What's the vision that God has for his creation? And what's the vocation of humans with regards to non-human creation? As we study these relationships within creation, we can't help but to learn more about the Creator. As Thomas Aquinas wrote, any error about creation also leads to an error about God. So studying creation carefully should clarify our thinking of God. As art historians know, we can learn about the artist by studying the art. Anyone who wants to learn about Da Vinci should study not just his journals, but also his art. Anyone studying Maya Angelou should read not just her 7 autobiographies, 7. My life is so much more boring than hers, but they should also obviously study her poetry. And any student of Lewis who read only his letters, but not as Narnia, would forever remain in the Shadowlands. To learn about the artist, study the art. Now, my hope for this talk is to develop a theology of nature, a theological ecology, by weaving together some insights from biblical theology and natural theology. I plan to lean on theologians from diverse denominational backgrounds, drawing from Lutherans like Terence Friedheim, some Anglicans like N.T. Wright and John Polkinghorne, Wesleyans like Howard Snyder, Presbyterians like G.K. Beale, Evangelicals like Richard Middleton and John Walton, and Catholics like Pope Francis, among others. In addition to these Western scholars, though, the Eastern Orthodox tradition has been too often overlooked in the West, and it provides vital insights toward developing a theological ecology. And tonight I'm going to draw from contemporary Orthodox scholars, such as Elizabeth Theokritoff, John Chrysippus, Callistos Ware, and John Zizulis, as well as patristic theologians like Maximus the Confessor and Irenaeus. And for good measure, we'll throw in some insights from my field, ecology, trying to tie it all together. So in the broadest Christian sense, I really hope tonight to develop a truly ecumenical theological ecology. All right. Rhetoricians tell me I need to state my thesis clearly, and I shouldn't bury it somewhere. So here it is. Here's the thesis. I'll argue we cannot develop a robust theological anthropology, what's it mean to be human, without also developing a robust theological ecology. What's the purpose of creation? If we want to understand the origin, vocation, and destiny of humans, we cannot do this apart from understanding the origin, vocation, and destiny of the entire cosmos. For the purpose, the telos of creation should be understood as God's temple. The cosmos is the temple of God. Under this thinking, then, the ethos of humanity is understood as creation's priests. The way we relate to creation is exemplified by the priest-temple relationship. Then the logos, lowercase l, of science, especially ecology, is necessary to inform our praxis as priests. In other words, ecology gives us the information we need to guide our relationship with the rest of creation. All right, then we need to correct some bad theology that views creation as anthropocentric. Now, by anthropocentric, I'm not denying that humans have a central position within creation, but I'm challenging the notion that creation exists primarily for us. Creation is theocentric. It's not anthropomonic. It's not all about us. And it's not anthropotelic. The ultimate purpose of creation is not found in humans. We also need to correct some bad science that views nature misanthropically. There are so many documentaries out there that talk about the world without us, suggesting the world would be better off if we weren't here. Now, true, many ecosystems would improve in the short term if we were to vanish, but that's short-sighted. When humans are in right relationship with creation, the relationship's neither anthropocentric nor misanthropic, Rather, properly viewed, creation is synanthropic. Now, I stole this term from Ecology. A synanthrope is a species that thrives because of humans. Think dandelions, right? They're definitely better off because of us. But when humans are in right relationship with creation, all creation should flourish, not just dandelions. All right, before I continue further, I mentioned that Dr. Ross Shaw's legacy lives large at SPU, and one very tangible way in which that is true is that Dr. Shaw's granddaughter is a student here, Matea Kurtz Shaw. She's a senior honors biology student, minoring in eco-theology, and Matea is also an accomplished singer and has sung with our treble chorale. At my urging, Matea has agreed to accompany me in this lecture. I divided the remainder of the talk into five parts, and Matea is going to introduce each of the parts with a selection from the hymnary. So with that intro, let's dive into part one, the paradox.
In labor all creation groans, till fear and trembling cease, till human hearts come to believe in Christ alone is peace. Be our peace, be our peace, be our peace, Christ our peace.
In labor, all creation groans. Now, conventional wisdom is that creation groans because the fall ushered in death. Prior to Adam and Eve eating the forbidden fruit, there was no death. Plants and animals and humans would have lived forever as originally intended in Edenic paradise. Very good meant no disease, no suffering, no death, and creation is now groaning because those sin-tainted relationships are decaying the world. Right? But let's start at the very beginning, right? Turns out it's a very good place to start. Who knew? All right? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And as God progressed through the creative days described in Genesis, we see that God repeatedly declared each day, good, good. All right? And then after the sixth day, when everything was there, God declared creation. Very good. You're on it. I like it. Thank you. All right? So from the beginning, we're assured that God, what God has made, is very good. But fast forward to Romans 8. And in Romans 8, we see Paul using this language. He's talking about creation being subjected to futility, in bondage to decay, and groaning in labor pains, from good to groaning. What's gone wrong? Now, I mentioned that conventional wisdom said that what's gone wrong is death and suffering. And here we see that in Alfred Lord Tennyson's famous poem, when he says, "Man who trusted God was love indeed, and love creation's final law, though nature red in tooth and claw with ravine shrieked against his creed." But that conventional wisdom doesn't square well with knowledge from the natural sciences. The Earth is over 4 billion years old. Humans have only been around for a couple hundred thousand years. If Earth's history were an hour, humans would have been around for the last 0.15 seconds. So there are literally billions of years of creaturely death in God's good creation that predate any possibility of human sin. Over 95% of all extinctions happened before humans even had a chance to sin. Predation and competition were rampant from the outset. Nature has always been red in tooth and claw. Decomposition, decay, and death were baked in. The lion has never lain with the lamb except to eat it. How can we consider competition, predation, and extinction, which all predated humans by millennia, part of God's very good creation? How are we going to interpret the groaning of creation and bondage to decay if pestilence, parasitism, and pain have been there all along. Well, to make sense of this, we need biblically and scientifically informed theology of nature. So it may be helpful to see what ecologists consider good about the natural world. In his field-defining paper, conservationist Michael Soule devotes nearly half his essay to the normative postulates of conservation biology. He tells us what's good. But good's not a word that shows up in most scientific papers. Though to do the work of conservation, we need to know what's good and what's bad. Soule's first two principles, the first, biodiversity of organisms is good, and second, ecological complexity is good. To me, this sounds a lot like the very good state of creation at the end of day six, after Earth's biodiversity and complexity have been established. Soule's third postulate, though, is a little bit rattling. Evolution is good. Now, time certainly doesn't permit a full discussion of how Christian ecologists view the long periods of creation compatible with the Genesis account. For that, you're welcome to take my intro bio class. But what I think is striking about this statement is not just that evolution occurs, but that evolution is good. The goal, then, of conservation biologists is to ensure not just that lions exist, but that lions roam the savanna and that lions continue to exert their selective pressures on zebras. In other words, what's good is that lions chase zebras, that lions kill zebras, that lions eat zebras, because those lions are contributing to the good of evolution. Nature is red in tooth and claw, but perhaps lions aren't shrieking against any creed. Perhaps lions are doing what they were created to do. After all, the psalmist does remind us, the young lions roar after their prey and seek their meat from God. To the ecologist, death, disease, and competition, decomposition are not bad. And what makes creation good, then, is that it is diverse, ordered, functional. The predator, it's good. The parasite, it's good. Decomposition, it's good. Smelly, good. Bacteria, good. Viruses, good. Just because I have to say it doesn't mean I like it. Okay? But these are all have God-given niches. Now, that doesn't mean all death is good. Untimely death is still bad. Untimely extinction at the hands of humans is bad. And human suffering is definitely not part of God's goodwill. But overall, creaturely death is good because that is part of the ordered ecosystem. This conclusion isn't just the unfortunate byproduct of evolutionary worldview, though. All right, I do this thought experiment with introductory biology class. Let's work, just for the sake of argument, from a young Earth model where the Earth was created in 6 days. On what day were bacteria made? Bible doesn't tell us, but let's go with day six. We'll go towards the end here, okay? Now, on what day did sin occur? Yeah, we don't know the exact day, but let's say we couldn't even make it a full day after the week. So we'll say sin started on day 8, right? There's 48 hours from when bacteria were made until sin could have entered the system. And do you know what happens if God started with just 2 lowly bacteria, just 2, on day 6, and then there's no competition or struggle for existence for 2 days, and bacteria get to produce exponentially? Do you know how many bacteria there are after 2 days? Enough bacteria to cover the world waist deep. That's not good. Creaturely death, even before the fall, is part of God's good creation, and it keeps the system ordered. So, when Paul refers to the groaning of creation, I don't think he's referring to any idea of natural evil or creaturely death. Yes, the Earth is in bondage to decay, but that decay shouldn't be confused with any biological processes like decomposition or disease, which are God-created components of a stable, balanced, functional, ordered ecosystem. From the moment God created, death was inherent. To all animals, including humans, God gave the plants as food, and even for a vegetarian, eating involves death. As an animal, to live is to eat, and to eat is to kill. Tofu kills soybeans. Won't someone think of the tofu, right? That's baked in. It's baked into a very good creation. So what did Paul mean by groaning? I think a clue in this is the idea that creation has been subjected to futility, and futility indicates that creation can't do what it was created to do. So sin has frustrated creation's telos. Paul's describing the groaning response of creation to the distorting effects of sin on humans' relationship with creation. In other words, when humans don't treat the creation the way that we're supposed to, creation suffers, groaning in bondage to decay. To better understand how humans are supposed to treat creation, though, we need to set aside Paul for a second and return to the garden, which brings us to part two, the presence.
This is my father's world. The birds their carols raise. The morning light, the lily white, declare their maker's praise. This is my father's world. He shines in all who hear. In the rocks and trees, over skies and seas, I hear him everywhere.
This is my father's world. By day six of the creation account, when creation is declared very good, the earth is no longer void and formless. Rather, it's ordered and functional. This is the ecological definition of good. The earth is full of biodiversity. The creatures are functioning in their ecological and evolutionary roles, predator, prey, and parasite. Balanced ecological interactions maintain the finely tuned order of creation. Bacteria are not covering the earth in a cesspool of putrescence. In this telling, though, humans aren't the climax of creation. To find the emphasis, the climax of the creation account, and the purpose of creation, we need to move to day seven, when, interestingly, no thing was made. The climax of creation is actually the rest of God. But what's meant by this rest? Surely God's not tuckered out and needs a little nap, and this is not just biblical justification for vegging out on Sunday and watching football. I find the work of Old Testament scholar John Walton particularly helpful here. Walton argues that the idea of a deity resting would be interpreted by ancient Near East civilizations with that deity taking up residence in its temple. Walton writes, "The seventh day is not a theological appendix to the creation account. It intimates the purpose of creation and of the cosmos. God not only sets up the cosmos so that people will have a place, he also sets up the cosmos to serve as his temple." Further, Walton writes, "The role of the temple in the ancient world is a place for the deity. It's sacred space. It's his home." N.T. Wright agrees. The creator's purpose was to fill his world with his glory, to rest and reign within his proper home. So the climax of the creation account is God indwelling his earthly temple home. This view of creation as God's home radically affirms the goodness of creation. And this interpretation also reveals creation's telos. The purpose of creation is to serve as God's cosmic home, the residence of the indwelling and fully present God, God's earthly temple. I never learned that in Sunday school. Maybe that's because this view of earth as God's temple, God's home, completely undermines the notion of earth being primarily for us. This, I think, has far-reaching implications for developing a theological ecology. And this may be a good place to point out that the word ecology comes from the Greek oikos, which means home. But maybe it's not just our home. Now we see it's not just our home, it's God's home. And G.K. Beale develops what he calls a biblical theology of the dwelling place of God. And Beale notes many similarities between Eden, the tabernacle, and the temple. For instance, the Jewish temple had all sorts of garden art inside of it. Eden and the temple were both on a hill. They both faced east. The lampstand in the temple was shaped like a tree to recall the tree of life in the garden. They're both guarded by cherubim. There's a ton of parallels between Eden and the temple. And when in Genesis 3:8, we read of God walking back and forth in the garden, the same Hebrew verbal form is used to describe God's presence in the tabernacle. When we view Eden as temple, we recognize that this truly is my Father's world. Now, if Eden was created as God's earthly temple in which God's holy presence would reside, and the purpose of creation was to serve as the dwelling place of God, what's the purpose of humans? Beale picks up this question and focuses our attention on the key passage of Genesis 2:15. Then the Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to tend, abad, and keep, shamar, to tend and to keep the garden. Beale notes that these two words are priestly words. Abad and shamar, he says, are painted with cultic colors. Walton notes that the majority of times that abad and shamar are used together in scripture, they're referring to priestly duties in the tabernacle. So Walton says the tasks given to Adam, tend and keep, are of a priestly nature, that is, caring for sacred space. So if Eden was the first temple, that makes Adam, and by extension humans, the first priests, put in the temple to tend and to keep the functional order. Next, we can turn to a parallel passage in Genesis 1 where we see the human's role described in priestly terms again. Now, much ink has been spilled over the subduing of the earth and having dominion. Dominion, Hebrew radah, has kingly implications. Much to be said about this, though I don't have time or space to do that tonight. Mike Langford tackles this one really well, pointing to Psalm 72 as a proper view of king as holy servant rather than dominating tyrant. And there's certainly connection between priestly service and kingly service. The people of God are, in fact, described as a royal priesthood. But I want to focus on priestly vocation tonight. And Beale looks at this line, fill the earth, and interprets this in light of God's presence being originally centered in Eden. Beale writes, the presence of God, which was initially to be limited to the garden temple of Eden, was then to be extended throughout the whole earth by his image bearers, as they themselves represented and reflected his glorious presence and attributes. Richard Middleton agrees, saying humans are the divinely designated mediators of the Creator's presence, extending the divine presence on earth. Like tending and keeping, this mediation of God's presence to creation is a priestly task. The idea of priest as mediator is everywhere in Greek Orthodoxy. And the idea of mediating God's presence to creation dates back to at least the 7th century with St. Maximus the Confessor, a name we're coming back to shortly. Now, in developing our theological ecology, we've established first and foremost that the purpose of creation is to glorify God, serving as God's dwelling place. Then, in developing a theological anthropology, we've established that humans are commissioned as priests to tend, to keep, and to extend, and to mediate God's presence to the wider world, facilitating the communion of creation with the Creator. Orthodox scholars John Ziziulis and John Chrysippus, names to which we'll return, developed this idea of humans as priests of creation. Ziziulis writes that man was given the Imago Dei not for himself, but for creation. And Chrysippus writes that priesthood is the royal vocation of all people, and the whole world becomes a cathedral. This is a beautiful picture. But unfortunately, the rest of the story does not go off without a hitch. Before we can address our present-day responsibilities as priests of creation, we must first address the regrettable reality. A long, long time ago, in a garden far, far away, we screwed up. Part 3, the partition.
Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not be, only thee, perfect in power, in love and purity.
The darkness hides thee. At the risk of stating the obvious, God's holy and God will not abide evil. Adam, the first priest, was commissioned to usher God's holy presence to the wider world, to extend Eden. But Adam failed. Rather than manifesting God's image outward so that all creation could enjoy God's unrestricted presence, Adam let sin inward, contaminating the garden. The consequences of sin were swift and drastic. Adam and Eve were excommunicated, banned from ever again sharing in that presence of God, where God walked back and forth through the garden in the cool of the day. The sin of the first priest had grave consequences, not just for humanity, but for all creation. As John Zizioulis writes, here lies for theology the root of the ecological problem. The human being rejected his role as priest of creation by making himself God in creation. This is what's typically referred to as the fall or original sin. And to understand the cosmic consequences of the fall, it might be helpful to contrast a couple different views of the fall. Now, much of the Western church teaches a model of the fall that traces back to the writings of Augustine. In this model, human sin resulted in the loss of human innocence. Humans became guilty of sin, and this guilt was transmitted from generation to generation so that all humans were born guilty of Adam's sin. This is essentially a genetic model of the fall, as guilt transmits like a bad gene from parent to offspring. And the effects of the fall are understood primarily in terms of humans. Humans have lost their innocence. Humans are born sinful. Humans need salvation. Orthodox scholar Eve Tibbs, though, writes that perhaps the deepest and widest chasm between Eastern Orthodox theology and Western Christian theology is seen in their respective views of the fall. Tibbs describes Orthodox theology interpreting the fall on an Irenaean model. In Irenaeus' thought, what was lost was not innocence, but communion. Because relationship between creation and the creator is central to this model, we could think of it as an ecological model of the fall, in contrast to Augustine's genetic model of the fall. According to Tibbs, in the Orthodox view of the ancestral sin, our ancestors' willful separation from the God of life separated all creation from the source of life itself. Consequently, communion with the creator has been lost, and all creation has become subject to destructive enemies, death, decay, and evil. Sin created a partition separating creator from creation. Communion was replaced with separation. In this Eastern interpretation of the fall, we see the consequences of sin extend far beyond humans. All creation groans because of its separation from the indwelling divine presence of God. Richard Middleton agrees, saying sin has shut earth off from God's full presence. This separation is deadly serious. As Irenaeus says, separation from God is death. And because of human sin, this is the fallen state in which creation finds itself. Like Irenaeus, Zizioulis also relates this cosmic separation to death. He argues that creation out of nothing, ex nihilo, that means creation's finite. If it had a beginning, it has an end. The only way, therefore, for finite creation can be saved from its finitude is through linkage or communion with the infinite creator. Communion, then, is cosmic salvation, and separation is cosmic death. This is why creation groans in futility. Sin has undermined creation's ability to serve as God's dwelling and to enjoy God's full presence. The cosmos has been partitioned from its source of life and is thus in bondage to decay. Holy, 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 though the darkness hides thee. Things are looking dark. Human sinned, God's goal of communion with creation spoiled. Separation brings death. It's bad. Fortunately, though, God's not done. No partition can forever separate God from his beloved creation. For God so loved the world. Cue part four, the priests.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. O ye who hear, now to God's temple draw near, join me in glad adoration.
Now to his temple draw near. So far in our development of a theological ecology, we've noted that death and decay have always been a part of the created order. The universe was created finite. The intent of God was to rest and dwell incarnate within his cosmic temple. So long as creation was in communion with the eternal and life-giving God, decay to oblivion was impossible. Humans, as God's image bearers, were commissioned to extend Eden and spread God's presence throughout creation, ushering life outward. But the original priests failed, and all creation was separated from God's presence, ushering death inward. Creation, intended as God's dwelling place, groans in futility because it cannot of its own accord fulfill its mission to praise the indwelling God. With me so far? All right. At this point, it's probably appropriate to pause and address a potential objection. On one hand, I've been talking about God's presence being partitioned, separated from creation. On the other hand, we regularly speak of God's omnipresence. God is everywhere. God is in this room. How can God be everywhere and be separated from creation? Well, it's theology, so it's complicated, right? But we know that God's presence manifests in different ways. God's presence now does not seem to equate with God's presence walking back and forth in the garden. And God's omnipresence seems different from God's glory presence in the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle and temple. And it certainly seems different from the picture of God's good presence in the New Jerusalem. Eastern Orthodoxy talks of God's essence being transcendent, but God's energies being immanent throughout creation. To be clear, the fall has not changed this immanence or this omnipresence, but for creation to truly live, God's indwelling presence needs to be restored. There's a post-biblical Jewish term here that might be particularly helpful, Shekinah, which refers to God's glory presence. Shekinah is actually a mashup of two Jewish words, shekan, to dwell, and mishkan, dwelling place, indicating God's intense indwelling presence in the tabernacle. So we could think of cosmic redemption as the realization of cosmic Shekinah. If the problem is that creation's been separated from the indwelling presence of God, redemption can be thought of as the restoration of the indwelling presence of God, God coming back to his earthly temple. Cosmic redemption means restoring the presence of God on earth as it is in heaven. And I think the rest of the scriptural story from Genesis through Revelation can be thought of as God restoring his indwelling presence, God coming back to his earthly home, consummating the promise in 1 Corinthians that God will be all in all. Now, the cosmic redemption story picks up back up after Eden, when God selects a people and a place, Israel, in which his presence would dwell. An opening act of God's homecoming story is found in Genesis 28, the famous story of Jacob's ladder. With all due respect to Led Zeppelin, this is not a stairway to heaven. This is a stairway from heaven. This is a picture of the heavenly God punching through the partition of sin and coming back to his home on earth. Should we miss that point, Jacob is sure to emphasize, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. Then, just in case you missed it, Jacob goes on to name that place Bethel, which means house of God. I know, right? It's like, it's right there. At Bethel, God announces his homecoming plan, the return of the king. Steward of Gondor, be warned. Now, remember, our story started way back in Edenic paradise, which on day 7, God indwelled. But sin screwed that up, replacing communion with separation. God's will won't ultimately be frustrated, though, so God established a people and a place wherein he would dwell, reestablishing sacred space within creation, which brings us to the story of Israel's tabernacle and later the temple. According to 1 Chronicles, we see the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Then Solomon said, "The Lord has said he would dwell in a dark cloud, but I have built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever." Now, Solomon's time horizon was a little overly optimistic with that one, but the point remains. God punched through the partition of sin, and God made his home in Israel, indwelling the tabernacle and later the temple. But with new covenant clarity, we see the temple was only temporary. Plot twist. The temple built by human hands pointed to a greater reality. Emmanuel, God with us. And John tells us the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. In Jesus, the new covenant's inaugurated, and it's important to note here a theme that's emphasized particularly well in Eastern Orthodoxy. It's not just the death and resurrection of Jesus that's important. The incarnation is super important as well. Jesus' life is not just a necessary first step to his death. By indwelling the cosmos and taking the form of a creature, Jesus, the great high priest, reunited the creation with the Creator. Jesus isn't just the sacrificial lamb. Jesus is the temple, the place of God's presence. And Jesus is the priest, the mediator of God's presence. Now, Jesus' life on earth lasted only a few short decades. But in perhaps the greatest understatement of all time, it shook things up just a little bit, especially with regards to the idea of restoring God's indwelling presence on earth. Jesus introduced the new covenant, ending the temple era with an emphatic table flip, right? As we see at Pentecost, God was no longer planning to indwell a temple made by human hands, but God, the Holy Spirit, indwelt his people. Did not see that one coming. As Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you. And Peter tells us you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. Now, with Christ as our model, we are both the dwelling place of God and the priestly mediators of God's presence to the whole world. Indwelt by God, we are priests of creation. Now, the idea of priests of creation dates back to the 7th century patristic saint, Maximus the Confessor, who described the priestly vocation of humans as microcosms and mediators. And who, it must be said, has hands down the coolest name of any patriarch? Maximus the Confessor. That is so cool. Anyway, microcosm refers to our unique position within creation as both material and spiritual. Then, because we're both material and spiritual, we can link the material finite creation with the divine infinite creator. According to Maximus, as priests of creation, our mission field is not just other humans. It's all creation. Linking creation with the creator then is done through the priestly Eucharistic act of elevation. Anaphora. You thought I was done with fancy words after Abad and Shamar. Now I'm going Greek on you. All right, watch out. Anyway, anaphora. Just as the priest of the Eucharist lifts the created elements of bread and wine to God in communion and for blessing, we as priests of creation lift creation to God in communion and for blessing, referring God's creation back to God. As Zizialis writes, this act of elevation, namely the referral of creator to its of creation to its creator, is the essence of our priesthood. Now, consciously or not, many of us use similar language in our prayers. For instance, we may lift up friends and family for prayer. Lord, we lift up the midlife crisis of Aunt Dolores. But why not also lift up the wildlife crisis of the Amazon forest? See what I did there? All right. Now, my next point is important. Hear this. If we do lift the forest up for blessing and healing, we don't just do that because local people need its resources for survival, which they do. And we don't just lift the forest up for healing and blessing because it might contain the next big anti-cancer medication, which it might. And we don't just lift the forest up for blessing because it scrubs our dirty carbon, which it does. We lift up the forest for blessing because it is good and because it is groaning and because it is God's. Callisto Swear tells us that when we elevate creation and refer it to God, humans are the bond and bridge of God's creation, uniting earth and heaven, making earth heavenly and heaven earthly. By lifting the voiceless, by lifting the forest, we give voice to the voiceless. Be the Lorax. Speak for the trees. St. Ignatius calls this liturgy a medicine of immortality. And John Chrysippus tells us that in nature, survival and salvation coincide. This is what I mean when I talk about priestly relationship between humans and the rest of creation being synanthropic. In this Eucharistic vision of the world, creation flourishes because we link it with the life-giving creator. Without this link, creation dies. All right, let's redraw our triangle. Let's put those fancy words in there, two Hebrew, one Greek, if you're keeping tabs, abad, shamar, and anaphora, and let's flesh out what these priestly words might mean for us today in more practical terms, because so far it's been abstract. First, abad, which we've translated as till and tend. And this is our proactive work in creation. From planting a garden to managing a national forest, this is the work of conservation, where we work to maintain and promote creation's biodiversity. This is where we chew on the tough questions of balancing the needs of people and the needs of the planet. In so doing, the conservation biologist recognizes first and foremost the intrinsic value of creation. It's good. We translated shamar as guarding and keeping. Now, if tilling and tending is our proactive work, then guarding and keeping is our protective work. This is the act of preservation, preached so effectively by John Muir, Henry David Thoreau, Rachel Carson, and others. If conservation seeks to balance the needs of people and the planet, preservation emphasizes that rule number one is to do no harm and prevent untimely extinction. Preservation recognizes not just the intrinsic value of creation, but its ecological value as well. Come on. And we just locked up. Oh. Can someone close to that computer give me a physical bump to the next point? There we go. I think we're good. Thank you. Assist. All right? So preservation recognizes not just the intrinsic value of creation, but also its interactive ecological value. Here, creation's not just good. It's good because it's ordered. And every member of the organization contributes to the overall goodness. Now, any of my ecology students could have told you there's no way I'm getting through this lecture without a quote from Aldo Leopold. So here it comes. All right? If the land mechanism as a whole is good, then every part is good, whether we understand it or not. To keep every cog and wheel is the first precaution of intelligent tinkering. Keeping every cog and wheel is shamar. Now, the work of conservation and preservation is difficult and often involves making difficult decisions and trade-offs. This then is where science comes in. The natural sciences investigate how creation works, and knowledge of the functioning of creation certainly contributes to our goal of keeping creation functional. But it's not just natural sciences. The social sciences are critical as well, as we weigh decisions and trade-offs. Economics, sociology, anthropology, political science, geography, psychology, and others need to contribute to this discussion of how best to tend and keep the earth. Now, if Abad and Shamar involve proactive and protective priestly work, then Anaphora, elevation, can be viewed as our consecrative work. If Abad is conservation and Shamar is preservation, then Anaphora is mediation, bridging the material with the spiritual. Here we don't just affirm the intrinsic and ecological value of creation, we also affirm creation's doxological value. It is good because it praises God. It is good because it is sacred. In this way, just as we can abad and shamar through the sciences, we anaphora through the arts and humanities. Owen, I did not conjugate that right. I'm sorry. Anyway, Chrysippus nicely links art, nature, and priesthood by asking us to see nature as a divinely written icon. In doing so, we serve as a priesthood of creation, fulfilling the task to which we were called. Through the arts and humanities, we can recognize creation as sacred and give creation a voice to praise its creator. Art is anaphora. Lifting up and referring creation to its creator is not mere metaphor. Any artists in the house? Listen up, you're about to get a shout out from a scientist. For Ziziolus, the acts of creating and offering back are the hallmark of priesthood, and it's the artists, the makers, that exemplify this the best. He writes, through creating, we can refashion creation in order to bring it into communion with God. We liberate it from decay, become its priest, offering it to God and Savior, and giving eternal meaning to things otherwise subject to decay and the passage of time. Art gives creation eternal meaning. Consecrating creation and elevating creation beyond the confines of decay. Now, I said I wanted to make this part more concrete, so perhaps an example or two of art as anaphora would be useful. I think this gathering, elevating, and offering of creation is described perfectly by Makoto Fujimura, whose work, Walking on Water, I've featured as the wallpaper for my title slides. Mako uses precious and intentionally prepared materials in a form of art that he calls an ecosystem, an integrated way of making that affirms the beauty of nature. Mako identifies the artist as co-creator with God, writing that this human act of making art is connected to the divine presence. Simply put, when we make art, God shows up. Maybe a more local example of this Eucharistic view of art would be helpful. In Touching This Leviathan, our own Peter Moe asks us to contemplate the utter incomprehensibility of the whale. Peter, sorry, dude, I have Moe in my notes, but I can't, I gotta call you Peter. Anyway, so Peter's book is not just about dry science. It's poetic, and it's wonderful. Peter, as poet and priest, lifts up the whale. No easy task, by the way, lifting up a whale. But priest Peter, with Atlas-like strength, lifts up the whale in respect and awe as paragon of mystery and wonder, asking not what are whales good for, but referring reverentially Leviathan back to its maker. Now, although I somewhat divided these up between art and science, there's obviously overlap among our priestly tasks. For instance, for creatures to praise God, they must first be preserved. Here, I think a helpful analogy is of creation as a choir singing God's praise. And then if we are the choir directors, our first rule should be to make sure that everyone in the choir has a voice. How can the choir of creation sing God's praise if we've shot the altos and cut down all the tenors? Yes, keeping every cog and wheel is the first rule, but tending and keeping a beautiful and doxological flower garden is as much art as it is science. To be priests of creation, we need the arts and sciences. This, by the way, is why creation is cheering the Christian liberal arts. And it should be noted, this is why the Christian liberal arts schools should be at the forefront of conservation, preservation, and arts. Can I get an amen from the people? Thank you. All right. Creation's groaning for the glorious indwelling presence of God, but sins partition creation from Creator. As priests of creation, though, we can link creation to the light and life of God, to tend and to keep and to elevate, to serve and preserve, to contemplate and consecrate, declaring to creation, all ye who hear, now to his temple, draw near. This is the holy work of the scientist and the artist, the physicist and philosopher, the ecologist and the economist, the painter and the poet, the priests of creation. As the modern ecological crisis shows, though, we have not yet arrived in paradise. You may have noticed the blank spot at the bottom of my chiasm of cosmic redemption. Sorry. Although the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus introduced the new covenant, we're not yet in the new Jerusalem. But there's hope. For a sneak peek of creation's consummation, we now turn to part five, which is also conveniently the consummation of this lecture. So part five, the perfection.
All thy works with joy surround the earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around the center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee.
Thank you, Matea. All thy works with joy surround thee, center of unbroken praise. At this point, we've established that the finite created order made ex nihilo is in bondage to decay, dependent on humans to fulfill their calling as priestly image bearers, tending, keeping, and lifting up creation, linking the material with the divine. In the words of N.T. Wright, this is the future creation groans for. Wright goes on to say that the presence of the Spirit within Jesus's people is the sign and guarantee of the same renewing presence within the whole of creation. The picture here is one of perfect cosmic redemption, an eschatological paradise wherein Psalm 72 is realized such that the whole earth will be filled with his glory. In short, God will indwell not just his people, but his entire creation. En route to this glorious consummation, though, we still need to clean up 2 points of pervasively bad theology that undermine our priestly calling. First, God's salvation is not limited to humans. Too often, the church's work is defined as saving souls. Redemption and renewal are not limited to humans. They are holistic and cosmic in scope. This message is everywhere in Scripture. Remember, for God so loved the world. As Wesleyan scholar Howard Snyder writes in his excellent book, Salvation Means Creation Healed, the hope of Romans 8:20 is the hope of creation healed, the marriage of earth and heaven. The Orthodox refer to this marriage of heaven and earth as theosis, the consummation of creation through communion with the Creator. So salvation's not just about saving souls. It's about God saving the whole created order. Seriously, read Howard Snyder's book. It's awesome. And while you're at it, read some Greek Orthodox theology. It's awesome too. But the second point of bad theology that undermines the importance of our priestly task is the misperception of where we spend eternity. After death, where will you live forever? Spoiler, it's not away from earth in heaven. In the last days, we do not evacuate an obliviated earth to be with God forever in heaven. We do not fly away to heaven, nor does God call us home to heaven. Professor Richard Middleton offers cash rewards to his seminary students to see if they can find a single clear New Testament reference to Christians living forever in heaven, or that heaven is the final home of believers. Heaven apart from earth is not our final home. True, our home is with God, but our home and God's future temple is on earth. The earth is where the bodily resurrected faithful spend eternity with God in creation. I'm not sure where the picture of us as disembodied souls strumming harps on poofy clouds came from, but it's not from the Bible. Although Revelation is definitely not clear about a lot of things, this one seems pretty clear. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among people, and he will dwell with them." In God's good future, the earth is redeemed and renewed by the restored presence of God. We don't fly away. The earth doesn't get annihilated in a ball of flames. No, heaven comes down to earth. In shock, John declares that in the New Jerusalem, there's no temple. The whole earth is God's consummated temple. God dwells with us. God's Shekinah permeates the earth as the waters cover the sea. This is the picture of the great perfection. There's no partition. There's only perfect shalom throughout the entire created order. These correctives are important because it means that our priestly work today matters. Our tending and keeping and lifting up, our writing and our painting, our science and our architecture, our gardening, our beautifying. As Mako the artist writes, what we build, design, and depict on this side of eternity matters, because in some mysterious way, those creations will become part of the future city of God. Similarly, N.T. Wright tells us, what we do in Christ and by the Spirit in the present is not wasted. It will last all the way into God's new world. I don't know what musical instruments we shall have to play Bach in God's new world, though I'm sure Bach's music will be there. In God's perfect future, the dwelling of God will be with his priests and all God's creatures. The temple curtain's not just torn, it's gone. As promised in Revelation 22, we along with all creation will finally see our Creator face to face, enjoying God's presence as God finally indwells his creation. All thy works with joy surround thee. Center of unbroken praise. In this talk, I've argued what's wrong with creation is not the God-ordained ecological interactions that give order to the system. Those are good. No, creation groans because human sin has partitioned the cosmos from its life-giving source. Humans, created to be the links between the material and spiritual, have failed at their priestly commission. This link, though, can be reestablished, thanks be to God. Through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, creation's great high priest, and the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit within God's people, we can recover our priestly ethos to tend, to keep, and to uplift creation in preparation for the glorious return of Christ to his earthly temple. It's not too late. And my goal tonight was not to give you the top 10 ways that you can green your life. There's lots of good sources you can look that up if you're so inclined. The problem is not enough Christians are inclined. My goal tonight was not so much to develop an ecological ethic, but an ecological ethos. Might attitudes and behaviors among believers change if we start teaching and preaching and believing that the earth is God's temple, God's home, and we're the temple priests? What would it mean for ecological relationships today if we viewed the earth not as our pantry, but as God's parlor? If we viewed creatures not as consumables to sate our pleasures, but as choir members to sing God's praises? Restoration could occur even now if, in giving voice to the voiceless, we lifted up not just the widow and orphan, but also the willow and orca. Revelation has given us a vision of what God's perfect future looks like. When Christ descends, though, will he see the ocean as his reflecting pool or our refuse pile? Will the returning king be greeted by streets of gold or grime? A crystal sea or a crappy sea? Priests of creation view mountains as monuments, islands as icons, wildlife as worshipers, timber as temple, conserving and consecrating God's good creation. This is the priestly ethos. This is the hope of a creation in bondage to decay. In tending and keeping and lifting up creation, we link creation to Creator. As priests of a groaning creation, these are our priestly tasks. It is not too late, but we must not fail again. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. How do you feel?
Oh, yeah, fire it up. Part six. No, just kidding.
Okay, I wrote down some words. So since we are not missing Thropek, we're going to open it up for questions. You see, apply your stuff. So we have about, let's see, I would say maybe about 13 minutes for questions. Then I have a minute to give Eric some bling, and then we'll go to refreshments. So anyone has any questions? Who wants to go first? Steve?
Eric, thank you so much. This is really great. I haven't thought this question through, so it's an honest question. And it's related not to the topic talk as a whole, the whole thesis, but just to a part of it. When you spoke of anaphora, in the traditions that you're citing, for particularly Eastern Orthodoxy and others, what's lifted up is not just the elements of creation, it is by that point in the liturgy, the body and blood of Christ.
Yes.
And I don't know where I'm going with this, except I'm just noticing here the Christological focus of this. You know, God is still incarnate.
Yes.
Forever incarnate. And I'm just curious if you have any, in other words, your talk, I guess, focused primarily on the human lifting up of trees and so forth. But in the liturgy, there's something even more to that, which is that it becomes transformed into the very body and blood of Jesus.
Yes.
And so I'm just curious if you have.
So the question here is, drawing from the Greek Orthodox tradition, and this is definitely something that varies denomination by denomination, what happens at the Eucharist. That's kind of a big question. But in the Greek tradition, the elements are lifted up, and then they are actually indwelled at that point, right? With transubstantiation, they become, right? Like Jesus is there in that tradition. So that's important to the Greek Orthodox thinking of what's going on in anaphora. They are lifted up not just to be blessed, but to almost literally be indwelled at that point. And so I think that's, it's not surprising that this idea of anaphora and relating it to the presence of God came through a faith tradition wherein transubstantiation is a substantial part of their theology, where Christ is indwelled in it. Another thing I didn't mention is for Zizioulas, who ties in the art to this, he says it's And it's also important that these are not wheat and grapes that are lifted up, but this is bread and wine that's lifted up, which shows this kind of effort on behalf of humans to transform creative elements and then lift them to God for further blessing to then be poured back out into creation. So it's not, you know, it's not just done here. It's the work we do, lifted for blessing, getting indwelled, and poured back out. It's a really rich metaphor, I think.
Look who it is.
I know.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, look at that. We're out of time. I don't know.
Oh, my God. Happy to see you.
Thank you, Eric. So much to say here. Just a couple of things for start. One is this idea that the lack of communion with God. I don't get that. God communicates with all kinds of people in Jesus' Bible, starting with Cain, Noah, Abraham. Jacob thought he wrestled with him. Might be wrong, but that's what he thought. And you quoted Jacob as having the right theology of the latter. So if he's right there, maybe right there, or wrong on both. How in the world can one, or anyone, argue that God is not communicating? It's all over the place. Then the second thing, and then I'll sit down. For the bad theology you want to deal with, how about the fall? Why is it that no one, no prophet, no one, all the way that Israel is being blasted for sin, no one ever blames it on Adam mm-hmm. or Eve? Mm-hmm. The garden story does not function in the prophetic stuff. So I'll just stop there.
Okay. Yeah, good. I hope I don't want to conflate communion with communication. I would certainly say God communicates still. And I want to draw on that idea of Shekinah, where there's like, you know, there's communion and there's communion. And there's presence and there's presence. And we can see theophanies throughout the Old Testament. We can see these instances, these rare instances of the burning bush, or we can see God showing up in unusual formats. But the default isn't the same as what we see with perhaps God walking through the garden, and it's certainly different from what we see in the Holy of Holies, and it's definitely different. Like, I guess the way I would say is, well, then what's different about now as opposed to the New Jerusalem? There is a communion that we have, and there's a communion that God has with all of God's creation in New Jerusalem that we don't have now. So maybe I didn't use the best words, I don't know, but I'm trying to convey the idea that there was something different, and there will be something different, and where we are now, it's not where we should be. Okay, so yes, God absolutely communicates with his people, and I really tried to, I knew that this could be an issue when we say, like, well, what about that omnipresence? Like, God is here, absolutely. And again, I think the Greek Orthodox idea of the immanence throughout creation, but the essence being transcendent, and trying to walk that balance between immanence versus transcendent and having both at the same time. And there's some mystery there. But I still think we're just, whatever was in Eden and whatever is in New Jerusalem is not where we are now. But God can punch through, and God has done that with Jacob's ladder, with the burning bush, with indwelling the tabernacle, and with indwelling the temple, among other instances, and certainly Christ. Right? So we see God repeatedly punching through. But when Christ died on the cross, the temple curtain was torn, but there was still a temple curtain. Right? It's not gone. There's still a temple, and we're working towards removing that. So that's kind of how I think about that. The story with Adam and Eve, again, I think where Irenaeus is right on this, is that is kind of in a correct, well, it's order, right? He came before Augustine. But Augustine is so much about, like, what happened to humans, what happened to humans, what happened to humans. But when we think about this as a separation or a partition, which is, again, I think exemplified by the temple curtain, there's a partition. Right? And if no sin, there's no partition. So whether we're going to blame it on Adam and Eve, or we're going to blame it on some other form of sin entering the world, the end result is a partition that was never designed to be there, and that will come down, at the end. Maybe I satisfied, maybe not. Well, while I've got your attention, Dr. Spina, I do have to say that one of the reasons that I got on this talk was because we had Dr. Walton here speaking, and you responded to that. And you didn't have a lot of time because Dr. Walton went over his time, but it was good. And I was so glad for Dr. Walton and what he said, because it's put me on this right track. And one of the things when you said at the end is, like, I totally think Dr. Walton is on the right track with Eden being temple. And my mind blew at that point with Eden being temple.
I think Genesis 1 is temple.
Yeah, Genesis 1. You're,
Eden is a garden.
Thank you. Yes. And now the Eden, well, okay, we could geek out, but... We got Eden, we got the Garden of Eden, we got the wider world. It's tripartite space with the most holiness in the middle, which is the same as the Holy of Holies, the holy place, and the temple courts. Both of them are arranged in tripartite space, sacred space, with the most sacred place being in the middle, which is where God's presence is. So we see that Eden, garden, wider world. We see that manifested in Holy of Holies, temple courts. Holy of Holies, Holy Place, Temple Courts. Pretty cool parallels.
I love this so much. All my worlds are overlapping. We go to church together. My pastor's here. He's loving it too. I'm totally convinced, I love this argument so much. So I'm a practical theologian, and I want to know, what does the Long family do differently? Because they believe they are priests living in God's temple, because I want to conform my life to be more like a priest living in God's temple as well.
So you want my top 10 tips to green your lifestyle? Is that where I'm at?
Maybe.
Yeah. We do a lot of things different. And my wife's here, and we are partners in this endeavor, and we've got a lot of really good role models in this as well. I'd say one of the quotes that's really formed for me is, every dollar you spend is a vote you cast for the type of world you want to live in. And so we're very intentional about where our money goes. So when we purchase intentionally. We buy used whenever we can, because that has a much lower environmental footprint or carbon footprint because of that. We eat really oddly, and it's wonderful, and worshipfully. And this is a shout out to Karina, because she's very intentional about the way we eat. I mean, we it's a privileged position, because it's expensive to do this, but we really try to track the sources of where our food comes from. And we try to eat intentionally, because so much of, you know, carbon footprint, or whatever you want to call it, is going into your diet. We eat nutritionally, and we eat as much as we can in ways that the food is grown so that it doesn't hurt the world in which it's grown. And the wonderful thing about that is that it is, you know, it's not an either or. Eating that type of food is good for you, and it's good for the land. It's a win-win on that. Unfortunately, it's expensive. And this is why I said we need economists, and we need political scientists, and we need anthropologists and sociologists and nutritionists. I didn't put that in the list, but we should, right? When we get to these questions of trade-offs, but like, so where should we send our money? Science can't answer all these, but this is where we need the social sciences as well. We eat really low on the food chain. I think that's an important thing as well. I walk whenever I can. Again, that's a privileged thing, that I live in a place where I can walk to a grocery store. I know there's a lot of places that are food deserts, and you can't do that. But whenever I can, Dr. Long throws on his big old goofy camping backpack and walks to the grocery store and loads it up with 2 gallons of milk and however much else will fit in there, and walks back home. But again, that's good for me and good for the environment. It's a win-win that way.
Okay, this is perfect. Perfect. All right. So this is where we do the close.
Already,
and I get to do something super cool. I'm so excited. Okay. So two things that Dr. Long gets for putting all this intellectual effort into blessing us tonight is that he gets an honorarium, which is direct deposited into his check. And then... I know you thought I was going to have a check, huh? Okay. And then he gets this. Do y'all see it? Yeah, I looked at some past videos, and apparently it's called academic bling. So I got to put it on Dr. Long, and I don't think their heels tall enough for me to do this, but I am excited. Okay, are you ready? Yeah. Okay, let's make sure.
You want me to stay with
you?
Thank you.
This is great. So thank you for attending. Thank you for communing with us. I feel like we could do this every week at 7 o'clock, right? Totally. So at this point, you are free to go and enjoy refreshments. And yeah, just reach home safely. Goodbye.